Well, hello. Thanks so much for being with us today. We're so excited to worship. If you're in the room, stand. If you're at home, go ahead and stand with us anyway. Let's worship together. Let's sing together today. Together we lift our voices in this room, at home, online, wherever we find ourselves, declaring there is one name above every other. There is one name where every knee will bow and tongue confess as Lord of all. There is one name that we worship and lift high today in this place, and that's the name of Jesus. It's wonderful, a wonderful counselor, a mighty God, Prince of Peace. And so we lift that together today. That you are Savior, you are Lord. You are Forgiver, Restorer, Redeemer. Light, Life, the Way. You are so many things. So God, be glorified in our worship today. Be glorified now in this moment where we set apart, that we take a piece of bread and we take a cup of juice and we remember your love demonstrated on a cross. We remember just to what lengths you were willing to go so that we might have relationship with you now and for all eternity. And so God, we accept that free gift, but we understand in this moment that it wasn't free, that it cost your son, that it was his blood that washed away our sins. And so in this moment now, we remember that, we thank you for that, we praise you for that. And it's in Jesus' name, our mighty God's name, that we pray, amen. Amen. You can have a seat.
So we are Phil and Angela Chrysler. We live in Plantation, and we've been coming to Community since 2005.
We have two daughters. When we started at Community, we had one. She was little, and we were at the little church, matter of fact. It was before we had this beautiful building that we're in today. We were glad to get started there at Community, and we actually both got baptized there.
That's
and then
right.
Our oldest has gotten baptized here at the new church, and our youngest, we hope she will get baptized in the next couple of years as well.
So when the Cannonball Initiative came to be, we had started tithing with Community back when we joined in 2005. And then when the Cannonball Commitment came, for us, it was an easier decision. Here's why. When you understand that the blessings that you have are appreciated, but they're not, they're provided, they're given by God. The blessings that we receive in the assets, the financial aspect of everything we have is temporary, right? Our job is to be a good steward between the dash, right? The time you were born and the time that you are called home. And so your responsibility is to be a good steward for those assets. And once you understand that, for me, it gives you tremendous financial peace. And so you want to share, you want to invest in the good message with the Cannonball Initiative, and that's what we wanted to do.
So we were excited to participate, and for us, what we decided to do is, since we were already tithing every week, is we would just increase our tithe. Mm-hmm. And so that way, just every week, we could get used to that additional money going to the church,
that's
and
right.
We would adjust based on that. And we definitely have done that. Now, there have been, difficult times in this two-year journey, as there have been for others. For example, 2020 has been an adventure. And I like to call it an adventure because it's been a very unique year for many families and businesses and individuals. It's history making. And our business is the same. We've had highs and lows in 2020. We've had things postponed. And those all hurt our bottom line, which then hurt our income. But for Phil and I, we had made that decision early on, and even through the highs and lows, we knew that money we had already given to God, we'd already given to church.
So, with the Cannonball Initiative, right, we get to be an investor, we get to be a partner with the good work that the church is doing, and it's an investment that we're happy to make because it's worldwide. What you're doing with the Cannonball Initiative can bring hope to many here in the United States. But beyond that, that's what excites us is the footprint that we have as a partner with Community, with the Cannonball Initiative, to bring God into so many more lives that need it across this great land.
I want every family to feel like we do when we come to community. We feel loved, we feel prayed for, we feel supported in our highs and our lows. I love that community wants to celebrate our successes and wants to hug us through the difficult moments. There's gonna be difficult times in the future, but community is a place that you know you can feel loved, you can feel supported, and you can feel proud supporting their efforts, whether it's Cannonball or the next initiative. We definitely want to be part of it.
We are the Chryslers,
and we are still all in.
Yeah, that's another great Cannonball story. Lori and I are really good friends with Phil and Angela, and they are the real deal. And Phil and Angela have been so very generous to community over the last 15 years. You may not know this, but much of the furniture that is in this building, in the lobbies in different places, and much of the furniture in our next gen building, the new building, was given to community through their company, Team National. And we're just very thankful for their generosity. I love what Phil said, that when we understand that our blessings are from God and our blessings are temporary, and that it's our job to be a steward of those blessings. And when we understand that, it gives us tremendous financial peace. I love what Angela said about the difficulties of this year, of 2020, the adventure of 2020, and we can all relate. And I love that she said, even in the difficulties, in the highs and the lows, that they determined to be faithful in keeping their commitment because it was to God and it was His. And I just grateful for Phil and Angela still being all in. I'm grateful for you, community family, for jumping in and making waves. I'm grateful for you determining that you were gonna be a world changer through your giving, through your generosity. And I just wanna go ahead and remind you that the generosity initiative of Cannonball, it's coming to a close at the end of this month. And so for those of us that made a 2-year commitment, I just wanna encourage you to join me and so many others. Let's finish strong and be faithful to the commitments that we made to God and His work here. And as we've jumped in, as we've made waves, and we've made a tremendous difference together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the privilege that it is to be a part of a very generous church. I thank you for, well, just the results, the fruit that we see again and again and again of what you're doing, of how you're moving in our midst and through the lives of others. Father, we thank you for the difference that has been made here in South Florida and on the other side of the world. Lord, I pray that you would just bless those who have honored you and trusted you in this area and that who give. Give either today in service or online or throughout this week. Just bless their lives. And Father, I pray that you would direct all of us as we strive to follow you. We pray this in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
Welcome to Community Christian Church, a place to believe, belong, and become. We're so glad you are joining us for our service today. Visit our website, communitycc.com, for more information about our church, including live in-person services, church online, and programming for your children and students. Are you joining us for the first time today? If so, we're so glad you joined us, and we encourage you to text the word NEW to 954-280-7575, and we'll send you a free subscription to Right Now Media, an online library of Christian videos similar to Netflix. Here are some other exciting things coming up at Community.
Christmas is right around the corner, and since it's the most wonderful time of year, we hope that you start off this season with a one-of-a-kind, family-centered event celebrating the Christmas story, simply. Community Kids wants to invite families with preschoolers and elementary kids to Jingle Jam. During our Jingle Jam interactive show, families will experience Christmas games, sing Christmas songs, and focus on hope, joy, peace, and love, while having some fun retelling the Christmas story. So invite your friends, your neighbors, and anyone with kids, and join us for Jingle Jam, a Christmas party big enough for your whole family. Showtimes for socially distanced, in-person attendance are Friday, December 18th at 7 p.m. or Sunday, December 20th at 1 p.m. Visit communitycc.com/Jingle Jam for the link to register your family for in-person attendance or watch online on any of our online channels. See you there!
Help us make a difference for those right here in our local community who have been impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic. Volunteers are needed for our next Feeding South Florida food distribution serve. For more information, including the registration link to sign up to serve, visit communitycc.com/COVID-19outreach.
2020 has been something, hasn't it? We've all felt it in one way or another, and my guess is that at some point throughout this year, we've all felt alone. Every time we gather, either in person or online, we are reminded that is not the case. Well, we are excited to invite you to Christmas at Community this year to celebrate this season where God entered the world he created and is now with us. We are not alone. So join us at one of our four Christmas Eve services. We will have one on Wednesday, the 23rd at 7 p.m., and then three on the 24th at 3, 5, and 7 p.m., all of them identical. Our campus is nearly construction-free, so we expect there to be plenty of room for you and your children, even as we stay socially distanced. We will have programming for birth through fifth grade available and even have a couple outdoor venues available in our new courtyard and on the terrace of the new Next Gen building. We have an incredible team of people working hard to clean and sanitize our building between services so you can feel safe when you come on our campus. For those of you still not ready or able to be here in person, don't worry. All of our services will be available online as usual. For those of you who are ready, remember, we are ready for you and we want to see you. So whether we get to see you in person or you engage online, we hope that you join us for Christmas at Community.
Hey community, we are so excited to announce our grand opening celebration for our new building. You don't want to miss this special day. On this day, we'll celebrate the completion of both our Next Gen building and the renovation of our existing building. This grand opening celebration will be your day to take a tour of our Next Gen building and see our new preschool classes, our children's area, the student ministry location, the terrace staff offices, and the courtyard. You can take your tour before or after the worship service that you attend. Also on this day, we'll be celebrating our Cannonball journey over the last 2 years, how God worked in us and through us for his glory. 2 years ago, we made generosity commitments to jump in and make waves, and we're gonna celebrate all that God has done. Plan to wear your Cannonball t-shirt. It's gonna be such a great day, and you don't wanna miss it. Well, how are you guys doing today? Doing pretty well? Good to hear. It's a pretty amazing week, wasn't it, weather-wise in South Florida, so glad that you're here. I want to welcome those of you that are watching online as well. I just want to give a quick update on our grand opening celebration. We recorded that video probably about a month ago, and we determined that we would do something that we've never done before at a grand opening for a building, and we're actually going to have a ribbon-cutting event, a ribbon-cutting ceremony. We're going to do it between the two services, and so what's going to happen next week for our Cannonball celebration grand opening for our Next Gen building and all of those partitions that are back there in our auditorium, those are going to get removed. We're going to have 800 more seats, and which is going to be great. At some point, we're going to need those, and so that's going to be a good thing. But next week, right after the first service that starts at 9:30, ends at 10:30, we're going to have the first service people walk over to the courtyard. And those of you that are here, that you want to be a part of the ribbon cutting event, you need to come early, and you can come around 10:30, 10:35, because around 10:40, it's going to be brief, about 15 minutes. And then we're going to have this ribbon cutting event, and then we're going to open up our Next Gen building, and then you'll be able to take a tour of the building. So we hope that you'll join us. And if you haven't been back yet, this will be a great time for you to come back for our grand opening celebration next Sunday. I can't wait. It's going to be a good day. And again, wear your t-shirt for your Cannonball t-shirt if you have one of those. Well, last week we looked at Mary, the mother of Jesus, and we're going to look at Mary again today as we attempt to recapture the wonder of Christmas. I have a lot of favorite authors. I still think I remember the conversation. I was on phone with a Bible college student that had been in our youth group that was in Cincinnati, and he told me about this new author that I'd never heard of, Max Licato. It's actually Licato. I thought it was Licato for a number of years. And he told me about this book that had come out called God Came Near. And when I got it, it was like, wow, this is the writing was unlike anything that I had read before. It's such a gift, and Max Lucado has been one of my favorite writers ever since. And so, since we're talking about Mary, in this book, God Came Near, which is about the incarnation, the coming of Jesus, there's one little chapter about 25 questions that he would like to ask Mary. Now, this isn't descriptive of his really great language, but I thought it was interesting as we get started today. So one of the questions that he would like to ask Mary is, Mary, did you ever feel awkward teaching Jesus how he created the world? Did you ever see a distant look on his face as if he were listening to someone that you couldn't hear? Did he have any friends by the name of Judas? Very interesting. When he saw a lamb being led to slaughter, did he act differently? Do you ever count the stars with him and succeed? Did you ever think, Mary, that's God eating my soup? This question's for Mary. Mark Lowry wrote a great song a number of years ago, also asking Mary some questions. The song is, Mary, Did You Know? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered would soon deliver you. Mary, did you know? I don't think she did. Completely. I think so many of this, there was gradual revelations of what it actually meant, but I think she knew. I mean, certainly she knew when Gabriel the angel told her that she was highly favored of God and she would become the mother of the Son of God. It's been said that life is not defined by how many breaths you take, but how many times your breath is taken away. When was the last time your breath was taken away by God? When was the last time that you gasped at God's goodness? When was the last time that the manger took your breath away? If you have your Bible, go ahead and turn to Luke chapter 2. We're going to be in Luke 2 today. And one of the impressive things about Mary, the mother of Jesus, is the way that she received God's favor. And Luke 2 tells us that after the shepherds came and informed Mary and Joseph about the angelic declaration, the presence of the angelic host, that in Luke 2:19, Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. Now, Mary wasn't one to brag. She wasn't one to exaggerate. She wasn't one to put all the focus on herself, but she did treasure these events, and she did have this deep abiding appreciation for God's grace in her life. In Luke 2:33, it relates that a few days later now that the child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. That was 8 days later. So today what I want to do is I want to look at Mary and how she continued to marvel, to have this sense of awe, to have this sense of wonder at the coming of the Messiah, to help us to recapture that sense of awe, to recapture that sense of wonder in our own lives. And so that's what I'd like to try to accomplish today. Now, last week, we talked about how the angel Gabriel appeared to Mary personally to inform her that she was going to give birth to the Messiah. And of all the women in the world, she was highly favored of God. In Luke chapter 1, verse 30, it reads, "But the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. And he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end.'" And she never forgot that moment. I mean, she replayed, I mean, how could you? When an angel has this announcement to you, but it shaped her. And she replayed that over and over and over again throughout her life. And we read in the account in Luke chapter 2 about the actual birth of Jesus. In verse 4, it says, "So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and to the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn." And when Mary held baby Jesus in her arms, she marveled. Just like any mom would marvel at the birth of their child, but it was unique because Mary marveled at this miracle of birth because her son was the Messiah. Her son was the Son of God. It was a few hours after Jesus was born that Mary and Joseph were awakened by a frantic knock on the stable door. The shepherds had rushed from the field, and they started to say, "Hey, is there a little baby in there?" And Joseph said, "Yes, there is. Well, why do you ask?" He says, "Well, we were out in the field, and we were asleep or half asleep, and then all of a sudden the sky just lit up, and there was an angel. And then there was a host of angels, and they were singing, 'Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill to men.' And they told us that there was a baby that was born that was in Bethlehem, and if we went, we could find a baby in a stable and a manger." "Is there a baby in there?" "Yes." Can we see him?" And they came in, and you know that when all these scruffy shepherds were surrounding the King of Kings, the Messiah, that Mary's heart had to start beating fast again. And she's just reminded again and again about this child who would be the savior of the world, her son. And she marveled at that. Sometime later, some wise men or magi, they knocked on the door of the house where Joseph and Mary were staying. Perhaps they were staying at the home of a distant relative in Bethlehem. This is sometime later now. And they said, "We have a most unusual request. We've come from a distant land, but we saw this spectacular star in the sky. And in our country, when we see a star like that, it's an indication, it's a sign that there's been the birth of royalty, and we've come to worship this king. Are you hosting royalty in this house? Is there a child king in here?" "Yes, there is. Would you like to see him?" "Yes, we would. Come on in." And then we read in Matthew chapter 2, verse 11, on coming to the house, they saw the child, and with his mother, Mary, they bowed down, and they worshiped him. And then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. Now, Mary's attitude towards all of these events was one of awe. I mean, Luke 2:19 tells us that Mary is developing this mental scrapbook. She's playing these videos again and again, these loops in Luke 2:19, but Mary treasured up all these things, and she pondered these things. She thought about these things. She replayed these things in her heart again and again and again. When the prophets said that Jesus would be a savior, even though she already knew that, we read in Luke 2:33, the child's father and mother, they marveled at what was said about Jesus, just additional confirmation about who Jesus would become. And when Jesus was 12 years old and he was teaching the teachers in the temple, we read in Luke 2:51, then after this now, he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. But his mother, she treasured these things in her heart. Awe, treasured, pondered, wonder. She just gave thanks to the blessings of God in her life again and again and again. And she never lost that sense of wonder. I think one lesson that we can learn from Mary is that we need to develop a sense of awe at Christmas. We do. We just need to develop a sense of awe at Christmas. I think one of our problems is that nothing excites us anymore. I mean, nothing really amazes us anymore. I mean, we say, you know, everything's amazing. And then really, because everything's amazing, nothing is amazing. I mean, for some, for all of its wonder, life is just ho-hum. It's blah, it's boring. Despite its gadgetry, life has lost all of its sparkle, its zest, its surprise, its wow. And does anything thrill you anymore? Many of us have a kind of been there, done that, got the t-shirt mindset. Nothing amazes us. Nothing really thrills us or causes us to wonder anymore. I mean, some of you right now are saying, you know, I don't get very excited about Christmas. I mean, I've been through so many Christmases. I don't really get very excited about Christmas. Others maybe, you know, this has been a hard year. It's been a terrible year. And I just want to get through it. Some of us haven't had a terrible year, but, well, we're not really overly excited about Christmas. I mean, maybe we have the same Christmas spirit as this guy whose house is on the right. There are a lot of pictures like this that are out there. I mean, you can just search for this. I selected this one specifically. And the reason that I did is that this guy, you see underneath the word ditto, you see the little arrow pointing to the house? He doesn't even bother to light the arrow. Everybody else would light the arrow. He goes, ditto, blah, 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 whatever, that guy. I mean, that's his Christmas spirit. Christmas doesn't excite you anymore. But don't you wish that it did? Don't you? I mean, really? Revelation chapter 2, verse 4 says, "You have left your first love." And I really believe that when God is in a life, that life marvels. That life has a sense of awe. That life has a sense of wonder. That life treasures. Elizabeth, we talked about last week. I mean, she was filled with the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist, he leaped in his mother's womb at 6 months before, 3 months before he was born, he's already declaring Jesus to be the Messiah, the Savior of the world. The shepherds, they rejoiced. The angels, they worshiped. And Joseph and Mary, they just marveled. They marveled again and again and again. This past week, I posted on social media, sermon help. What are some things you do to recapture the wonder of Christmas? I knew I was going to talk about this, and I thought I might be able to, you know, include an idea or two. I had no idea that I would have over 170 posts to this question out there. What are some things you do to recapture the wonder of Christmas? And there are many that you would, you know, expect. Remember Christmases from my childhood. Bake cookies and share them with others. Listen to Christmas music. It feeds my soul. Go look at the Christmas lights in neighborhood. Read Luke chapter 2 on Christmas Eve with the family. Read Luke chapter 2 on Christmas Day with the family. Different variations of that. Watch Christmas movies such as Elf. How many of you make sure that you watch Elf during the Christmas season? Okay, that's on our watch list. We love that. And how many of you watch much less, but one of our favorites is It's a Wonderful Life. It's a great, great film. And then there's Home Alone. I mean, anybody watch that one? Okay. And then there's the movie Die Hard, which is a great Christmas film. It's great Christmas, really kind of tugs on the heartstrings. Okay. I know there's always the debate of whether Die Hard's really a Christmas film or not, but... And most of the suggestions were serious and thought-provoking and helpful, but some of them were frankly just funny. And the funniest one was by my daughter-in-law, Alex. I mean, she lives now, they moved in from North Carolina to South Carolina, but Alex, thumbs up on this one. This was good. Alex put as what she does to recapture the wonder, is she said, "I lay under the tree to remind my family that I am a gift." Isn't that great? That was a good one. Some of you are going to do that. And a pastor friend, Jim Book, said feats of strength and Festivus pole. Some of you get that, some of you won't, but we'll just move on. There's some really interesting and helpful suggestions that I'm going to interject within the remaining part of this message, which I hope will be very practical in helping us to recapture the wonder of the grace of God and his blessings in our life, especially as they're found at Christmas. And the first thing that I want to encourage you to do is count your spiritual blessings. And if you've been around community for longer than 5 minutes, you're probably not surprised at that. It's like, Scott, you talk about that every single week. You talked about it last week about being grateful and counting your blessings. I do. Usually it's not in the notes, and it's just something that bubbles up because I just feel so passionately and strongly about choosing to be a grateful person, because gratitude chases away discouragement and disappointment, despair, and everything. But if you want to recapture the wonder of Christmas, I think you count not just your blessings, but you count your spiritual blessings. Children have written some great letters to Santa over the years, and I've collected some of those. One of my favorites is this one. "Dear Santa, you didn't bring me anything good last year. You didn't bring me anything good the year before that. This is your last chance." Albert. Albert's putting Santa on notice, evidently. Now, kids aren't the only ones that write letters at Christmas. I mean, adults write letters, and they write, you know, kind of like the year update, and I love those. And I get a few of those every year, and I read every single one of those. I mean, I might not read them until, you know, around the new year, because it's a busy time for me, but I read them all, and I love to find out what people were up to that during the year, and we write a letter. And maybe you write a letter that doesn't talk about, you know, all the material blessings that you've had this past year, but maybe you write a letter, and it's not even to other people, but it's you write a letter to God, thanking him for the spiritual blessings of this past year. Have you seen God at work in your life this past year? Have you seen him answer prayer? Have you deepened in your knowledge of the Bible? Have you seen your kids grow in their faith? Has someone in your family become a Christ follower this year? In the midst of the difficulty of 2020, have you still been able to see God at work in your life? And you write some of those things down and you count your spiritual blessings. And when you do that, it'll help you to recapture the wonder of God's grace, the wonder of his mercy, the wonder of Christmas, and just be grateful to God for what he's done in your life. We have spiritual blessings that are available to us only because God so loved this world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life, the gift of Christmas. And that's why we have these blessings. And so we stop and count our spiritual blessings, and we're filled with wonder. In Psalm chapter 118, verse 24 says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and let's be glad in it." And we do. One of the responses to my post was by a pastor friend, Brewster McLeod. And he said, "It'd be, you know, a great idea is to take a star, a Christmas star, and write the name of the person that led you to faith in Jesus. And just like the star led the magi or the wise men to Jesus, here's the name of the person who led you to Jesus. And you're reminded of that person, and you're grateful, and you choose joy because of the faith that you have. And you count that as a blessing. Second thing I think that we could do to recapture the wonder of Christmas is to use creative reminders. And there's all kinds of things that we can do as it comes to creative reminders. And I've heard of different families that they'll maybe get a couple of families together, maybe in COVID it's just your family or whatever, but you decide, you have somebody that has some dramatic ability and they dress up like a shepherd in shepherd's garb, and you sit the kids down and the person comes in and they tell about their experience that night. We were asleep and it was in the middle of the night, and then all of a sudden the sky, it just lit up, and there's these angels, and they talk about that account of the angelic announcement, and then how they rushed to Bethlehem and they found the baby Jesus, and the shepherd tells that story the first Christmas, and they tell it in a captivating and compelling way. You know, the kids' eyes are going to be open, and when you see Christmas through the eyes of children, it'll help you to recapture the wonder. It's a great idea, something really good to do. Someone said that what they do is when they get Christmas cards in, they take all the Christmas cards and they put them in a box and they put them in the middle, that box in the middle of the table. And every time they have a family meal at night, and then they'll take one card out and they'll read the card and then they'll pray, you know, for that family. That's a great idea. Jackie Split from Community, she posted on my post. She said, "Seeing the wonder and the awe of Christmas through the kids' reaction is so magical to me." And then she said, and some other people said this, that we bake a birthday cake for Jesus. And I like what she said. And we have a special plate for him to remind us of his presence. And Peggy Urbaneja from Community wrote, we place thank you notes in mailboxes for neighbors who have faith-based lawn decorations. I never would have thought of this. It's a great idea. And the thank you note just simply says, "Thank you for keeping Christ in Christmas." Great, great idea. As Christmas Day was winding down, a family friend who was visiting the holidays asked a five-year-old daughter if she got everything that she wanted for Christmas. And the little girl paused for a moment and she goes, "No, but it wasn't my birthday." And we want kids to get it, that it's not their birthday, that they're honoring the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, that they're celebrating his birth, and it's a special time And we use creative reminders to be able to do that. There's so many different creative ways. And I got to tell you, I mean, over 170 comments, I can only scratch the surface. I encourage you to go to the wall and just read down. There's so many great ideas of things to do there. As much as I love to sing Christmas hymns and songs, Joy to the World, Oh, Come All Ye Faithful, Silent Night. As much as I love to sing those songs, I really appreciate the fact that Craig and our worship team will sing new songs for us, new songs for Christmas. Psalm chapter 40, verse 3 says, He put a new song in my mouth. Sometimes it needs to be a new song. Sometimes it needs to be a new song for the old story, so we hear it in a fresh way. And then there's another way that we can make Christmas filled with wonder, and this isn't going to be possible for everyone in this room, but if it is possible, then do it. Have exposure to children. Have exposure to children. There's just something about seeing Christmas through the eyes of children. When you see the expressions of joy, the sparkle in the eyes of kids as they sing about the birth of Jesus, it's contagious. It's infectious, and we're able to see the coming of Jesus through their eyes. The prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 6 said, a little child will lead them. And we see Christmas through their eyes. I love this story. Carol Herdick from Community, she posted this, and she said, this Thanksgiving weekend, John and I took two of her granddaughters on an evening drive, and they appropriately oohed and awed at all the brightly decorated houses until we came to this very dark street. And 5-year-old Kate cried out from the back seat, these people don't care about Christmas or Jesus or anything. I just love that little story. I mean, kids are just so honest, and I love that response. There's a sense in which little children have a wonder about Christmas that is just contagious. And so make an effort to have exposure to children, if it's possible. It's not going to be for everyone. But this next one is possible for all of us, and this is one of the greatest things that you can do if you want to recapture the wonder of Christmas is learn to give generously. I mean, giving is transformational in our heart and our spirit. I mean, I'm not talking about maxing out your credit cards. I'm not talking about spoiling your kids or spoiling your grandkids. I'm talking about giving, you know, to a needy person or giving to a cause that you believe in. I mean, the wise men, they gave the gifts of gold and incense or frankincense and myrrh, and then they worship Jesus through their generosity, through their gifts. And God gave very generously the gift of his one and only son. Jesus told us in Acts chapter 20, verse 35, and we know this to be true, that it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. And we know the truth of that. And there are just so many great suggestions under this idea, this concept, this theme of learning to give generously. Because the truth is that for some of us, it's same old, same old. And we've never done that. We've never given generously. We've never given to somebody in need. And we've, you know, I don't want to be taken advantage of. Or for whatever rationalization maybe we have, but we just haven't done that. So I want to encourage you. And if you've never done this, I want to challenge you. It could be the game changer for you this Christmas. It's frankly, it's my favorite part of Christmas. It is. And Peggy Bellis wrote this. She said, we randomly pay for meals of service personnel. Just the other day, we paid for a table full of police officers anonymously. Way to go, Peggy and John. Ed Martin is a pastor friend of mine. He's a great guy. I haven't seen him in years, but he's pastor of Community Christian Church in Noonan, Georgia. Noonan is outside of Atlanta area. It's a multi-site church, and it's a great church. And Ed is just this great guy. And he wrote this. He said, I walk around with cash in my pocket. December is the only month when I carry cash. I ask God to lead me to someone who needs it. And when I find them, I give them the money. It's my favorite part of Christmas. That's a great idea. There's another pastor friend that saw that, Dale Roberts, and he wrote on the post, I try to follow Ed Martin around every December. And so, pastors. There's another pastor, Gary Cox, and I talk about Gary from time to time. Lori and I are really good friends of Gary and Linda, and he's pastor at First Christian in Fort Myers, Florida. And I knew Gary would have a great idea. He said, buy gift cards and randomly give them out in stores as God prompts. He said, I listened to a young couple in Target wanting a nice car seat, but they were going to settle for a cheap one. And he said, been there. So I handed them a $50 gift card and said, get the good one. Merry Christmas. He said, I love their expressions. And then he said, it's great because we're all wearing masks, so no one knows who I am. Great idea, Gary. Just learn to give generously. Penny Delatorre wrote, one year I bought a bunch of $5 McDonald's gift cards and gave them out to homeless people as I went through my normal driving commute, my normal driving routine. What a great idea. Thank you for sharing that, Penny. That'd be a great thing for so many of us to do. We want to do something, but we're not sure, and how awesome is that? So we learn to give generously, and that helps us to recapture the wonder. And maybe that's the thing that you need to do this Christmas. If you haven't done that before, you'll see it can be the best part of Christmas. We also, I think, we need to listen to this story with fresh ears. I mean, we've heard this story so many times, so we listen to this story with fresh ears. Jesus said in Luke chapter 8, verse 8, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Sometimes it's like you go over to somebody's house and they have a grandfather clock and it's close to you, but you didn't even notice when you sat down and you can't hear it. It's not making any noises at all. And all of a sudden in the middle of a conversation, it chimes really loudly and you just jump out of your seat and you're startled and they go, what happened? What happened? And you go, what do you mean what happened? That noise, it just startled me. And they go, oh, that. We've heard that so many times over the years. We don't even hear it anymore. And that's the way it is for some of us in this room. We've heard the birth story of Jesus so many times that we don't even hear it anymore. It doesn't even move us anymore. So friend, as we close this service, would you just open up your heart? Would you open up your mind a little bit? Maybe kind of wipe the sleep from your eyes when it comes to this story that may be so threadbare to you. You've heard it so many times. I want you to listen to this section from a book by Ken Geyer, his book, Moments with the Savior, that really makes the Christmas story come alive for me. So what I'm gonna do as we close this message today, I'm just gonna ask if you would just close your eyes right where you're at. And then I just want you to try to visualize. I want you to try to visualize the words that I speak and just kind of create this scene, this movie in your own mind, the coming of the Messiah, the King of the world. The night is still when Joseph creaks open the stable door. The stench is pungent and humid. For the innkeeper, there's not been enough hours in the day to tend to the guest, let alone the livestock. A small oil lamp flickers to dance shadows on the walls, a disquieting place for a woman in the throes of childbirth, far from home, from family, far from what she had expected for her firstborn. But Mary makes no complaint. It's a relief just to finally get off that donkey. She leans back against the wall, her feet swollen, her back aching, contractions growing stronger and getting closer now. Joseph's eyes darting around the stable. Feeding trough will have to do for a crib. Hay will serve as a mattress and blankets, his robe, that'll do. And those rags hung out to dry, they will help. A gripping contraction doubles Mary over and sends him racing for a bucket of water. The birth would not be easy for the mother or the child, for every royal privilege for this son ended at conception. A scream from Mary knifes the calm of this silent night. Joseph returns breathless, water sloshing from the wooden bucket. Sweat pours from Mary's face as her husband, the most unlikely midwife in all Judea, stands by her side. The involuntary contractions are not enough, and Mary has to push with all of her strength. With one final effort and a long sigh, her labor is over. The Messiah has arrived, the Son of the Most High. God has been born to a lowly Jewish girl. The baby chokes and coughs, and Joseph instinctively turns him over and clears his throat. Then he cries. Mary reaches for the shivering baby. She lays him on her chest, and his helpless cries subside. His tiny head bobs around on the unfamiliar terrain. This will be the first thing the infant king learns. Mary can feel his racing heartbeat as he gropes to nurse. Deity nursing from a young maiden's breast. Could anything be more puzzling or more profound? Joseph sits exhausted, silent, yet full of wonder. The baby finishes in size, and the divine word is reduced to a few unintelligible sounds. Then, for the first time, he fixes his eyes on his mother's. For the first time, deity straining to focus, the light of the world squinting. Tears pool in her eyes as she touches his tiny hand, and hands that once sculpted mountain ranges cling to her finger. She looks up at Joseph through a watery veil as their souls touch. He crowds closer, cheek to cheek with his betrothed, and together they stare in awe at the baby Jesus, whose heavy eyelids begin to close. It's been a long journey. The king is tired. And so, with barely a ripple of notice, God stepped into the warm lake of humanity without protocol and without pretension. Where you would have expected angels, there were only flies. Where you would have expected heads of state, there were only donkeys, a few haltered cows, a nervous band of sheep, a tethered camel, and a string of curious field mice. Except for Joseph, there was no one to share Mary's pain or her joy. Oh yes, there were angels announcing the Savior's arrival, but only to a band of blue-collar shepherds. And yes, a magnificent star shone in the sky to mark his birthplace, but only three foreigners bothered to look up and follow it. Thus, in the little town of Bethlehem, that one silent night, the royal birth of God's Son tiptoed quietly by as the world slept. Heavenly Father, we come to you just so grateful that in Jesus you have sent us a rescuer, a deliverer, a king, a Messiah, our hope. Father, we thank you that through Christ Jesus our sins can be forgiven and washed away, that through Jesus we can have the hope of heaven one day, that through Jesus we can have purpose in this life right now in the here and now. Father, it's my prayer that you, through your Spirit, would do what you do so well, that you would prompt and nudge us so that we could recapture the wonder. God, that we would just realize that we are just blessings of your amazing grace, that we're the beneficiaries of your hope. God, I thank you for the way that you have moved in history and the way that you move in our lives. God, help us to recapture the wonder of your grace. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.